Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Clay Legionary by J. Clifton Slater. Narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Act 1. Prodigy. Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines prodigy as a young person who is unusually gifted with special talent. These advanced talents, no matter how extreme, tend to be beneficial for those associated with the prodigy. A prodigy can come from many different fields: musical prodigy, mathematical prodigy, engineering prodigy, literary prodigy, or artistic prodigy. Usually, the talented child poses no threat to strangers who encounter the youth. However, dig a little deeper into the Latin origin of the word, and you'll uncover a threatening dark side. The etymology of prodigy is prodigium. Prodigium means omen or monster. Thus, the gifted can then become the feared. Now imagine the gifted youth as a swordsman prodigy. Chapter 1. Cooperative Village. Alerio Sisera broke from the corner of the schoolhouse and sprinted away with one thought in mind: escape. The path lay across the yard and threaded between two grain storage buildings. With arms pumping and knees raising and falling, he raced towards the trail leading to his home and safety. The buildings grew closer, and his escape seemed assured. For the last year, three older boys had terrorized him and the younger students in his small class. The bullying began with pushing and verbal harassment, but recently, the levels of aggression had sunk to a new low. Physical punishment and petty theft were now part of their itinerary of pain and suffering. Unfortunately for Alerio, he became a primary target when the older boys discovered his father had been an optio in the Legion. Each of the three boys' fathers had served short stints in the Republic's army. Their fathers carried resentment for NCOs when they were discharged. They passed on the negative emotions to their boys. He reached the alley between the grain buildings with a vision of open fields in sight. Relief washed over Alerio as he slowed. Suddenly, his attempted escape was abruptly cut off.
"Going somewhere, Sisera?"
one of the boys asked as the three stepped into his path. One circled around behind Alerio. The one who had spoken shoved his face in close, as if to dare the younger boy to take a swing. The third boy moved close to Alerio's side.
"What? No time to say hello?"
he whispered in Alerio's ear.
"Got to get home to your stolen land and that pretty mother of yours."
Alerio's hands clenched into fists. His face reddened at the mention of his mother, and he started to punch the boy. But the boy on his side had placed a foot between his legs, and when the boy behind him pushed, Alerio found himself face first on the ground. A kick to his ribs rolled him over, and he lay looking up at the three sneering faces.
"What do you have for us today?"
one asked as he reached down and plucked the pouch from Alerio's belt.
"Your payment for stealing our best land,"
he explained as he spilled the content of the pouch into his hand. He distributed the 5 copper coins to his companions. The iron spinning top he kept for himself. A dried root shaped like a dragon was tossed to the ground beside Alerio. As the young boy watched, a heel pulverized the dragon into shredded mulch.
"Do better tomorrow. I'd like a new knife,"
another of the boys said as he bent down. He ended the instructions with a hard punch to the center of his victim's chest. It was then Alerio cried out in frustration. The physical pain was temporary, while the mental anguish burned deeply into his mind. Plus, he knew tomorrow would bring more abuse from the older boys. Chapter 2. The Sisera's Farm. He left the small village behind and raced down the path towards his home. The trees surrounding the small villa came into view, and the dread faded. faded until he entered the kitchen and met his mother. In a panic, she asked,
"What happened to your face?"
A cloth was dipped in a bowl of water and applied to his cheek. It came away stained with dirt and blood. His mother studied the bruise.
"Was it those boys again?"
she asked as she dabbed at his cheek. Then she added,
"I'll have your father speak to their fathers." No, I fell,"
he lied. The thought of his father being involved in the dispute was unbearable. Alerio imagined it would make the assaults worse, and he'd rather face the boys alone than have his father interfere. Over the last year, his father had tried to teach him self-defense, but his tendons were too immature to apply wrestling holds, his arms too thin and undersized for boxing, so after those attempts, his father gave up on teaching him to fight. The afternoon was filled with chores, and Alerio had already put the fight behind him. At dinner, he avoided the eyes of his parents and his two older sisters. They ate, and his father talked about planting and the need to rotate fields. Alerio had stopped listening when his sisters interrupted to comment on the scrapes and scabs on his face. His father didn't comment. He simply looked long and hard at the injuries. For the remainder of the meal, Alerio feared that his father would become involved. After dinner, retired Optio Sisera motioned for Alerio to follow. He guided the boy through the courtyard, around the grain separation racks, and into a storage shed. Three walls of the shed held farming tools. On the fourth, hung weapons. Large, heavy infantry shields and smaller shields used by skirmishers occupied the center and lower part of the wall. Shelves above and beside the shields were filled with javelins, bows, and swords. The senior Sisera reached under the shields and moved a barrel filled with arrows. From the recess, he pulled out a wooden sword. He swung it effortlessly a few times before carrying it outside. Alerio followed. They walked around to the rear of the shed, and Alerio's chest swelled with pride at the farm. What once had been a rocky, barren track was now a field of grain. Stalks swayed in the evening breeze and appeared golden in the light of the setting sun. Between the rock wall at the edge of the field and the shed, a tree trunk had been planted. It stood taller than the boy and was twice his thickness. Stripped of its bark, the post appeared to glow golden in the fading light. Alerio watched as the retired Optio laid the wooden sword against the shed, struck flint, and lit a lantern. He hung the lantern from the roof's overhang before picking up the sword.
"This is a recruit training, Gladius," his father stated as he walked to the tree trunk gripping the sword in one hand. "You strike the post from the side twice, before swinging the sword to the opposite side and striking it backhandedly. Twice and once, then repeat." He demonstrated the two slashes and one backhanded strike before handing the sword to Alerio. The tip of the wooden sword drooped towards the ground. Alerio had played with his father's gladius when he was younger. It had taken two hands to hold the short sword, yet he had been able to lift it. The wooden sword was almost twice the weight of the metal weapon. "It's heavy, so when you transition to a real gladius, you'll be stronger and better able to handle the drills," his father explained. "Practice until you get tired, then come in and clean up."
His father disappeared around the shed, and Alerio concentrated on lifting the sword tip from the dirt. He managed three repetitions before his right arm gave out. In frustration, he switched to his left hand and managed only two repetitions. With the sword back in his right hand, he struck twice, but as he shifted the gladius to the opposite side of the post for the backhand strike, the wooden sword slipped from his hand. It landed in the dirt. Chapter 3. The Sisera's Villa. In the weeks that followed, Alerio managed to evade the older boys. When they did catch him, he noticed their punches weren't as devastating. Compared to the burning and soreness from the sword practice, their attempts seemed weak. One day he returned home to find his father entertaining company. Two big men sat on the patio talking with the former sergeant. They were laughing, and each held a clay mug of vino.
"Alerio, come here," his father said, calling him over.
Dropping an arm over his shoulders, he stated proudly to the men,
"This is my boy, Alerio. This is Centurion Ephraim and Optio Aegidius. We served together in the Legion."
Alerio was taken by surprise. His father wasn't expressive with his emotions. He worked hard, treated his family and slaves fairly, but he was stingy with his praise.
"I can see much of you in him," Centurion Ephraim observed. "Back when you were a scrawny, raw recruit who didn't know the difference between a shovel and a gladius."
"I know the difference, sir," Alerio boasted.
"Oh, you do, do you?"
Centurion Ephraim asked. He stood, pulled his sword, and spoke to the other man.
"Optio Aegidius, give the boy your gladius."
The Optio slid his weapon free and handed it to Alerio hilt first. Compared to the heavy wooden sword, it seemed light.
"Let's see what you know,"
the centurion demanded, holding out his weapon. Alerio wasn't sure what to do. He swung twice at the other man's blade, before swinging to the other side and backhanding the opposite side. Ephraim's sword rocked from the blows.
"Impressive," the man said. "Now strike harder, and I'll provide resistance."
This time, Alerio's gladius didn't rock his opponent's blade. It was as if he were striking the unmoving post. On the backhand move, the centurion's blade struck back. Alerio's sword stopped cold, jarring him from hand to shoulder. His fingers went numb, and the tip of the sword touched the ground. Even in that state, he didn't drop the weapon.
"That wasn't fair to the lad, Centurion,"
Optio Aegidius scolded.
"Better he learn defeat now than think himself an expert and die from ignorance," the infantry officer said. "Had enough, boy."
Retired Sergeant Sisera hadn't said a word during the drill. He did have an odd look on his face.
"No, sir,"
Alerio replied as he switched the gladius to his left hand. He brought the blade up to guard position and waited. Centurion Ephraim smiled and glanced over at the former Optio.
"Sisera, did you teach him to be ambidextrous?"
"Not me, Centurion,"
Alerio's father replied.
"I was never that good a swordsman."
"All right, young Alerio,"
Ephraim said, bringing his blade up to touch blades with the boy.
"Begin."
This time, Alerio was ready for the counterstrike. While it stung, it wasn't disabling, and he managed to fend off the centurion for a flurry before the older man's strength won the drill.
"Optio, if it's all right with you," Centurion Ephraim offered, "I'd like to train the boy while we're here. He has promise."
Alerio hadn't thought about being ambidextrous. He'd been switching hands because he could only swing at the post with the training sword for so long with one hand. In order to prolong the training, he had switched from right to left and left to right. Centurion Ephraim and Optio Aegidius were on fall furlough from the Western Legion. Both men grew up in the capital, and neither wanted to go from the orderly life of a legionary to the chaos of a city. So they'd accepted former Optio Sisera's offer of home-cooked meals, wine, conversation, and a soft bed in exchange for working the harvest. They'd leave well-fed with a few Republic gold coins in their pouches before returning to their duty post. During the 4 weeks before harvesting began, Centurion Ephraim drilled and taught Alerio. By the time the sickles, shovels, and baskets were distributed, Alerio knew all of the legionary drills. While not proficient at them all, he knew enough to practice each drill daily. Chapter 4. The Harvest. 2 years ago, for the harvest, Alerio had been assigned to the separating screens. Along with others, he scooped up handfuls of stalks and thrashed them until all the grain fell from the husks. He hadn't been that helpful, but he tried. Last year, he graduated to shovel duty. As the seeds filled the space under the screens, he and others shoveled the grain from under the thrashing racks and into bags. He got more on the ground than in the bags, but he didn't get in anybody's way. He was standing along with all the able-bodied personnel on the farm, waiting for his father to hand out assignments. Alerio eyed the thrashing racks and screens, shovels and bags. If given a choice, he'd rather not be there. Because of the collective nature of thrashing, the people assigned to the racks made small talk and bad jokes from sunup to sundown. His other option was on the collecting crew. They followed the harvesters, picking up armloads of hacked down stalks and placing them in the wagons. When a wagon was full, a handler guided the mule to the thrashing area. The work was hard on the back muscles, but the collectors rotated walking the mules and wagons to the racks. They'd get a little rest while the wagon was unloaded. Alerio figured he could do the work, but it was up to his father. So he waited. A big hand landed on his shoulder. He turned around to see who owned it.
"You ready, little man?"
Sergeant Egidius asked.
"Ready for what, Optio?"
Alerio replied. Egidius placed a sickle in the boy's hand.
"You're with me on harvesting duty,"
the Legion NCO advised him.
"I explained to your father that I needed someone who could keep up with me. He asked me who, and I said you. Are you ready?"
The harvesters were the first line attackers. They operated out front, cutting stalks as fast as the slowest cutter allowed. Cut too fast and your work went to waste, as your stalks lay on the ground absorbing moisture. Cut too slow, and you held up the entire operation as the advancing line waited for you to catch up.
"Cut low and keep up," Egidius advised. "But most of all, remember, when hard work has to be done, do it with good humor and a song. Defending a shield wall, breaching a barbarian horde, digging a ditch or harvesting grain, it's all the same. Hard work."
"Yes, Optio,"
Alerio replied. Chapter 5. The Grain Field. The next morning, a line of tall men and one boy stood at the edge of the field. As the sun broke over the horizon, a whistle sounded, sickles swung, and tall stalks of grain fell to the ground. The harvest had begun. Alerio's hand was sweating, and his right arm cramped. He switched the sickle to his left hand and kept chopping at the stalks. While not thick, the grain plants were plentiful, and each cut dropped a bunch. At one point, he staggered from exhaustion, but Egidius reached out and steadied him.
"This is hard work, lad," the sergeant advised him. "What do we do?"
"Thank the goddess Ceres for the opportunity to sweat in her name," Alerio replied.
"I think she'll take that offering," Egidius said.
Then he began to chant.
"Up each day to the rising sun, work all day till the work is done. Sound off, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Sickle in hand and a field ahead, going to chop all day till I'm dead. Sound off, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm a mighty man and can't be beat. Mounds of stalks laying around my feet. Sound off, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
On the second round of the chant, Alerio added his voice. By the fourth rendition, men on the line were chanting along with the Optio. When the sun reached overhead, food was delivered. They walked off the line and collected thick sandwiches.
"Hard work,"
Optio Egidius stated.
"Time for jokes and singing," Alerio replied.
His face was covered in pollen and dirt. Sweat had long ago dried them in a pattern of streaks. Yet the most pronounced feature was the smile on his young face. Former Optio Sisera arrived and began walking the cut. From time to time, he stopped and called a cutter over. After pointing out stalks chopped off too high, he moved over to inspect another row. High cuts were a waste, as the stalks, after thrashing, were used as animal feed. A stalk cut too high meant less feed per row. Sisera barely looked in Alerio's direction.
"Is something wrong?" the boy asked Egidius. "Father didn't come over."
"Right now he's not your father," the sergeant advised him. "He's in command of the harvest. I've seen him like that before, strolling around in the midst of a savage horde, calmly directing his legionaries. The last time I saw him, he was bleeding and fighting off a bunch of barbarians. Between strikes, he issued corrections to reform the battle line."
"So, him ignoring me is a good thing?" Alerio asked.
"Sure. If he'd come over, it would be to yell at us about high cuts," Egidius assured him. "When Optio Sisera is working, it's best not to draw his attention."
Alerio had seen the medals, the letters of commendation, and the weapons stash, but he'd never really thought about his father fighting in a battle. He didn't have long to ponder the thought. Egidius lightly tapped him with a fist.
"We're wasting a perfectly good day,"
the Optio said as he pulled Alerio to his feet.
"That grain isn't going to harvest itself."
"Up each day to the rising sun, work all day till the work is done. Sound off, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Alerio chanted as he marched to the edge of the tall grain stalks. Egidius cringed and added his voice. He sang louder, as much to mask the lad's rough singing as to motivate the other cutters. Chapter 6. The Great Room. 3 weeks later, former Optio Sisera and Centurion Ephraim were huddled around a table. While Sisera had run the harvest operation, Ephraim had been in charge of accounting with the village's grain commission.
"You mean to tell me we produced more grain and feed stock than the bigger farms?" Sisera questioned.
"That's correct, Optio," the centurion assured him. "I checked their books. It seems your homestead is tops when it comes to cashing in. I overheard a number of farmers complaining about your choice location."
"Choice location?"
Alerio's father spit out the words.
"Haven't they noticed the stone walls around my property? Where do they think they came from? The sky? No, my son, my staff, and I dug the rocks out one by one."
"Easy there, Sisera," the centurion said, attempting to calm the farmer. "They don't have the experience with farming that you do."
"You mean like having fish shipped in? Grinding them up with manure and spreading it over the fields," Sisera replied. "Or rotating the crops to rest the soil in sections?" "Yes, how did you learn that?"
Sergeant Egidius asked from across the room. Alerio and the Optio had been discussing fighting tactics. They'd barely paid any attention to the conversation until Sisera raised his voice. It didn't seem as if the retired Optio would answer, so Egidius asked again.
"How did you learn about fish and crop rotation? The boy should know." "During the Western campaign, there was a big battle," Sisera said.
His eyes looked at something beyond the walls of the room, and his voice dropped as if the memory was hard to relate.
"The battlefield had been a collection of farms. From the stunted crops, I could see the soil was poorer than the farmers working it. We met the barbarians in those fields. We stomped the crops and watered the soil with the blood and bones of legionaries and savages. Then we retired to our winter quarters."
"How did that teach you about farming?" Alerio asked his father.
"In the spring, we marched by the fields, but no farmers remained to plant them," Sisera reported. "But grass grew. Thick and tall, almost as if it had been planted by farmers. The next year, a group of families moved in and planted crops. The crops, where the soil had been so poor, the farmers were starving, filled sacks with grain only 2 years later. Bone, blood, and rest were the difference. Your father thought and talked about that all winter,
Optio Aegidius said.
We were ready to bury him in those fields by spring.
Good thing you didn't, the centurion remarked. It was that summer when the steady Optio Sisera saved our lives.
What? My father saved your lives?
Alerio asked excitedly.
How? Where?
When you're older, his father assured him. Now it's time for you to turn in.
Alerio, I understand you've had some trouble with three boys in the village,
Centurion Ephraim said, catching the boy before he left.
If you do tomorrow, look on the top of the fourth board on the right grain storage building. I left you something.
Chapter 7. The Cooperative Village. The time off from classes for the harvest hadn't changed Alerio's physique. He was still tall and thin with a gangly gait and prone to tripping over his own feet. If anything, the hours of work with the sword and the sickle gave him the appearance of being underweight. His appearance didn't disturb the three boys waiting for him at the grain storage building. One blocked the alley, while the other two spread out so he couldn't escape by going around the structures.
Your father cheated, and it's going to cost the other farmers,
one sneered.
What have you brought me?
Alerio looked from one boy to the other, then at the base of the right storage building. He counted up four boards. As he thought about what the centurion had placed there, one of the boys closed in on him. The first lesson from the centurion had been about footwork. It's hard to grab or hit a moving target. A soft scraping sound behind him identified one of the boys sneaking up. Alerio waited for the shove that would send him tumbling forward or backward to the ground. When the boy in front reached out, Alerio slapped his hands away, danced to the side, and yanked at the boy's arm. Caught by surprise, the boy tumbled forward. The two boys ended up grabbing each other.
That's sweet, Alerio teased. Harvest season is the time for love.
While the two boys attempted to untangle their limbs, the third boy ran at him. In the past, Alerio would have panicked and froze in place, making an easy target. This time, he reached out, grabbed an outstretched arm, and pulled while stepping swiftly to the side. The boy's momentum propelled him into the other two. The three fell to the ground. Alerio ran down the alley to the safety of the school building. In the afternoon, he didn't see the boys on his way home. He was at the villa before he remembered the present hidden on the storage building.
Chapter 8. The Bully's Turn. After dinner, while his father and his friends sat talking, Alerio went behind the shed and beat on the post. Between strikes, he danced patterns. For the first time, he understood the purpose of movement in a fight. And he understood the purpose of keeping level-headed and singing. With a steady rhythm, his practice became more intense and more focused. In the morning, he dressed and jogged to the storage building. Waiting for him were the three boys and a man.
You there, fish farmer,
the man yelled. Then he turned to one of the boys and inquired.
Is this the one who attacked you?
The boy nodded shyly and replied,
Yes, Dad. We were just hanging out when he came up and demanded our money.
What have you got to say for yourself? The man demanded. You owe my boy 5 coppers.
Alerio was stunned. For a year, the boys had beaten and robbed him. Now they were accusing him of being a thief. It was all he could do in the face of the absurd accusation. He laughed. The man took a step forward while asking,
Are you laughing at me? I'll give you something to laugh at.
His hand clamped down on Alerio's shoulder and his fingers dug painfully into the muscles. Alerio bent his knees, attempting to retreat down and away from the pressure. The hand followed, maintaining the painful clamp for a few seconds. Suddenly, the pain ended, and the farmer lay sprawled on the ground about 5 feet away.
Standing over him was Sergeant Egidius.
We can do this the hard way or the easy way,
Egidius suggested.
What's the easy way?
Asked the farmer.
I beat you and you bleed,
the optio replied.
What's the hard way?
The man asked with a hint of terror in his voice.
I beat you and you bleed,
the optio said with a smile.
I don't see the difference,
the confused man admitted.
Oh, there's not. But my old optio said to always give a man a choice in his punishment,
Egidius explained.
It helps get him invested in the consequences of his actions.
With the final word, the sergeant punched the man in the nose. As the farmer reached to cover his bleeding nostrils, Egidius jerked him to his feet.
Do you like little boys?
Egidius asked as he sank his fingers into the back of the man's thick neck.
How about big boys? We like to play too.
The man shuddered as the fingers closed in and the muscles yielded. He blinked, trying to separate the words from the action causing him pain and the blood streaming down his face. Alerio watched, fascinated. Optio Egidius hadn't lost his temper. Instead, he talked and destroyed the confused man in just a few moves.
Listen closely, Egidius said. This summer, I'll be passing through this village with 80 bloodthirsty, heavy infantrymen. If anything happens to Alerio or the Sisera farm, I'll bring my century to your estate. And guess what?
Is this another choice?
Sniffled the man as he coughed up a mouthful of blood.
Not this time,
Optio Egidius promised, dropping his voice. For the first time, he sounded threatening.
I'll come to your farm. I'll kill you and your entire family, your slaves and your livestock. And as your villa burns to the ground, I'll drink your best wine in salute.
You can't,
the man began, but Egidius buried his knuckles wrist deep in the man's stomach.
I can, and I will,
the optio stated.
Now get out of my sight before I change my mind about waiting till summer.
The man, supported by the boys, limped away.
Thank you, Optio,
Alerio acknowledged.
What did you learn?
Inquired the optio.
Stay calm, think ahead, keep your enemy off balance, and use economy of motion,
Alerio replied.
Did I miss anything?
Overwhelming violence,
Egidius added.
Don't give the enemy a chance to attack or counter.
The sergeant walked to the corner of the grain storage building and plucked a carved stick from between the boards. With a smile on his face, he took the trail back towards the Sisera farm. Alerio watched the Legion NCO for a long time before he turned and headed to the schoolhouse. Chapter 9. The Collection Town. 4 years later, Alerio Sisera's frame hadn't grown much taller. All the growth was horizontal. Where his back had been slender and boyish, it now pushed his tunic out as if he were hiding wings under the fabric. His arms and legs, once thin and reedy, were thick with no fat to hide the underlying muscles. After several long harvesting seasons, Centurion Ephraim and Optio Egidius had trained the farm lad to be an expert with the gladius and a talented tactician. On top of the skills, he was fast, athletic, and had a short fuse. Last year, he'd invited the three tormentors to a duel. Three against one with swords, knives, or javelins, whichever weapon they chose. Wisely, none of the three young men showed up at the appointed time or place. Alerio Sisera and four friends hitched a ride on the community's grain wagons. It was a 4-day trip to the nearest major collection town. While the commission would sell the farmers grain, Alerio and his companions would do some gambling and drinking, and maybe take in a show if they got around to it. The grain wagons were scheduled to return to the village after a 3-day layover. They'd be filled with goods for the homesteads and 5 hungover teens. Day 1 was spent at the better pubs. By day 2, the quality of the drinking establishments had gone downhill drastically. Sometime in the early hours of day 3, Alerio and friends staggered into a less than savory pub. The desperate came in 2 varieties: the dangerous or the despondent. The despondent were all huddled like sheep, clustered in the center of the common room or crowded around games of chance. All drugged or drunk, not all present except for their pathetic bodies. Their will gone and their minds broken. The solo dangerous lurked around the edges to the rear of the gamblers, seeking a loose pouch or an easy mark. The more ambitious of the dangerous stayed in the shadows along the walls, waiting and watching for wealthier victims. They had banded together in gangs and preferred planning and scheming their crimes, unless an obvious target wandered into their territory. When the 5 country lads walked in, 1 gang took note. The boys were singing a drinking song they'd picked up at a better place.
"Can the magistrate grant me an audience?" said the old woman on the gallows door. "For the judge is all blind, my old man all the time drinks the darkest red wine, and that's why he's dead on the floor. Can the magistrate grant me an audience?" said the old woman on the gallows door. "For the judge should relent, my old man never paid rent, our coin on drink he spent, and that's why he's dead on the floor. Can the magistrate grant me an audience?" said the old woman on the gallows door. "For the judge should be sacked, my old man knifed in the back, 'cause he winked at a lass, and that's why he's dead on the floor. Can the magistrate grant me an audience?" said the old woman on the gallows door. "For the judge failed to note, my old man gambled our goat and lost my wool red coat, and that's why he's dead on the floor."
Easy laughter and a slight stagger signaled to the gang the farm boy's state of drunkenness. As Alerio's group leaned on the rough wooden bar, the gang emerged from the shadows.
"See here, this is a fine establishment," a man said in greeting. "There's a fee for first-time visitors and bad singing."
Behind the man, 7 members of his crime syndicate spread out to trap the prey between their knives and the ale-stained oak bar.
"I don't see a sign," Alerio replied with a smile. "But I'll buy you a drink."
Alerio's vision was tunneling due to the quantity of ale and wine he'd consumed over 2 days of hard partying. The man was standing in the tunnel, so he was in focus. His 7 associates were not.
"Oh, my friend,"
the man said, smiling and displaying chipped teeth.
"The fee is 2 Republic silvers each for me and my friends."
It took a few seconds for the words to develop in Alerio's mind. Once the thoughts were formed, he scanned the men standing behind the talker. They all had knives cuffed in their palms. This wasn't a brawl where everyone walked away with black eyes and bruising. This was a knife fight.
"How many sweethearts have you brought to the dance?" Alerio said loudly.
He continued so his friends could hear.
"Let me count the darlings."
The man tilted his head out of confusion. What, he wondered, was the big lad from the boondocks talking about?
"I see you. You and you there in the back. Hello."
Alerio was animated as he pointed out and waved a friendly greeting to each member of the gang.
"And you there with the 2 big knives. Come closer. Yes, let me buy you a drink."
While Alerio blathered as if he was a village idiot, 2 of his friends managed to slip away. The other 2 moved closer, pretending to enjoy the show. In fact, They position themselves to guard Alerio's left side. The rogue holding the two long knives began to push forward. Anyone who flaunted two weapons was either an experienced fighter or overcompensating. Alerio wasn't thinking of that. He wasn't thinking at all. He was on automatic. The gang's mouthpiece was the closer target. Alerio lifted a foot and powered it into the man's kneecap. The leg snapped. As the man fell, Alerio caught him and flipped his body into the semicircle of thugs. Two knives tripped as the body rolled into his lower legs. He was forced to lean forward, his weapons still up in a guard position. Alerio plucked the knives from the unbalanced man's hands and headbutted him. The man fell away and disappeared in the tangle of men on the dirty floor. Two of the gang were still on their feet. They rushed forward. In their experience, most victims went on defense when faced with two attackers. Alerio simultaneously drove his left knife through one's neck while slashing open the other's belly with his right knife. The thugs fell, one holding his guts in his hands and the other gagging on his own blood. At this point, Alerio and his two remaining friends could have circled around the downed gang and left the seedy establishment. But Alerio wasn't thinking. He'd slipped into battle mode, and the first rule was to never let the enemy counterattack.
"You lads go now," he ordered his friends.
He was grinning and his eyes were sparkling.
"I've got to have a conversation with these guys. Run along now."
They left as Alerio flipped one of the long knives into the air and caught it. Then he flipped the other. The knives were off balance, more ground-down meat cleavers than proper cutlery. Nevertheless, they would do for this job.
"Who wants to dance?"
Alerio announced to the room. Everyone in the pub had stopped and was staring at the big youth standing at the bar flipping the knives. It started with a few, but soon became a stream as the bar's patrons rushed for the exit. Alerio ignored the fleeing customers. He scanned the gang members as he sang.
"Can the magistrate grant me an audience?" said the old woman on the gallows door. "For the judge should relent. My old man never paid rent. Our coin on drink he spent. And that's why they're dead on the floor."
One of the thugs began to stand. Alerio stepped to the man and with an underhanded swing, split the man's face from chin to forehead. Another pushed to his knees, and Alerio reached out and caressed his neck with a knife. Blood spurted as the blade sliced the artery. Before the man had time to bleed to death, Alerio jumped at another member who was scrambling to his feet. He received a foot to the face and a stab to the heart as he fell on his back. As a symbolic end, Alerio pulled the original owner of the two knives to his feet and drove both blades into the man's stomach. Then, still holding the man upright, reached back and snatched a mug of ale from the bar.
"I offered to buy you a drink,"
Alerio said as he drizzled the liquid over the dying man's face.
"You and your friends should have accepted the offer."
The body dropped to the floor, and Alerio took a long pull from the mug. Before he could set it back on the bar, four legionnaires, accompanied by a decanus and a tesserarius acting as optio of the city guard, flowed into the near-empty pub. Chapter 10. The Dangerous Pub. They saw a blood-splattered country boy leaning against the bar and singing out of tune.
"And that's why they're dead on the floor."
On the rough plank flooring, eight bodies lay in a semicircle around the lad's feet. The first thing that saved the boy's life, he was unarmed. In a small trading town, the city guard was composed of legion units on temporary assignment. A larger city would have a permanent city guard. They might be less prone to chopping down a criminal as he might be a neighbor or related to a wealthy family. The legionnaires who entered the bar didn't know the boy or particularly care whom he knew. They held no compunction about taking down a murderer, and the boy was certainly guilty of it, many times over. The second thing that saved Alerio Sisera's life was the acting sergeant of the guard. As a corporal standing in for a senior NCO, he wanted to get everything done legally and proper. It's why he'd accompanied the patrol when someone had called for help at the pub in this unsavory part of town. While the patrol with drawn gladii prepared to overwhelm the criminal, the Tesserarius put a hand on the arm of the Decanus.
"Hold!"
ordered the lance corporal in response to his corporal's signal. The four veterans stopped but held their gladii pointed at the boy.
"Put the mug down, lad, or die," the Tesserarius ordered. "I don't really care which."
Alerio turned his head slowly and tried to bring the troopers into focus. Then he did the third thing that saved his life. He set the heavy clay mug on the bar, braced at attention as Optio Aegidius had shown him, and announced,
"Tesserarius, Lance Corporal, good morning."
The two NCOs exchanged glances at the recognition of their rank. It wasn't uncommon for someone to know military ranks, but it was unusual for them to assume the position of attention.
"What's your name, lad?" the corporal asked.
"Alerio, Tesserarius," the country boy replied.
Now the corporal was really confused. His position in the sentry was that of the unit's treasurer. The boy's military knowledge and fighting skills didn't jive with his farmer's clothing or his youth.
"Turn around and put your hands behind your back," the corporal ordered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.